Welcome to the home of 100 to 1 Faith TV. I'm Larry Gent, and this is the message for Grace Hartwood United Methodist Church on January 10th, 2021. What have we learned here? Last week, we talked about epiphany, that moment when the light bulb comes on and an idea flashes into the brain, an aha moment. Our old friend Wile E. Coyote helped us to illustrate that moment. He was always getting flashes of genius in his pursuit of Roadrunner. Of course, his brilliant ideas always seemed to work out the same way, with an anvil falling on his head. He never seemed to learn, did he? Well, I wonder if we are any better. It's not hard to believe that 2020 was a pretty serious anvil dropped on all of us. Maybe we better pause to ask, what have we learned here? So let's begin with a word of prayer. Lord, your words are much more precious than gold, better than much pure gold. They are sweeter than honey dripping from the honeycomb. By them your servant is warned. In keeping them, there is great reward. But who can discern their own errors? Forgive our hidden faults and grant us wisdom to follow you. Amen. The responsive reading is from Psalm 19. The heavens declare the glory of God. The skies proclaim the work of his hands. Day after day, they pour forth speech. Night after night, they reveal knowledge. They have no speech. They use no words. No sound is heard from them. Yet their voice goes out into all the earth, their words to the ends of the world. Our Old Testament scripture is from Proverbs chapter 1. The Proverbs of Solomon, son of David, king of Israel, for gaining wisdom and instruction, for understanding words of insight, for receiving instruction in prudent behavior, doing what is right and just and fair, for giving prudence to those who are simple, knowledge and discretion to the young, to let the wise listen and add to their learning, and let the discerning get guidance. For understanding proverbs and parables, the sayings and riddles of the wise, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge, but fools despise wisdom and instruction. The New Testament reading is from 1 Corinthians 1. For the message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise. The intelligence of the intelligent I will frustrate. Where is the wise person? Where is the teacher of the law? Where is the philosopher of this age? Has not God made foolish the wisdom of the world? For since in the wisdom of God, the world through its wisdom did not know him, God was pleased through the foolishness of what was preached to save those who believe. Jews demand signs and Greeks look for wisdom, but we preach Christ crucified, a stumbling block to Jews and foolishness to Gentiles. But to those whom God has called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ, the power of God and the wisdom of God. For the foolishness of God is wiser than human wisdom, and the weakness of God is stronger than human strength. What kind of fool do you think I am? I hate falling for you all over again. I hate playing a game that I know I can't win. If you were with us through our study of Revelation last summer, I hope you remember the theme of that bewildering book. Say it with me now, God's gonna win. You may also recall that the most disturbing thing written in that book was that God sent one judgment after another, crisis upon crisis, not to destroy the world, but to get the world's attention. And time after time came the sad refrain, yet they did not repent, and they did not turn to the Lord. Well, if 2020 was not a big enough anvil to get our attention, if we didn't see enough crises to cause us to repent, I, for one, do not want to see what might be required to give us reason to pause and reflect. But if last year was not just a terrible inconvenience, but God's way of trying to get our attention, we can all agree that 2020 was a watershed moment in history. It will leave permanent changes in the way we work, in our healthcare, in our government, and in our business. But what about the church? Is it possible that God is trying to tell us some things about the way we think of church? Could those be the most important changes of all? The scriptures we read today are part of the Bible called wisdom literature. I took long, detailed, difficult courses on wisdom literature back in seminary, but I'm going to spare you all the deep scholarly discussions and sum up wisdom literature for you in just four words. Hey, don't be stupid. These scriptures are telling us to listen and learn. As a dad, I tried to put this lesson a little more gently to my kids. Like all kids, they made mistakes. And sometimes those mistakes hurt them or others they cared about. So I always tried to find a teachable moment to sit down with them and say, look, you've just had a rough experience, but in this life, there are no good or bad experiences. Experiences are just experiences. They're neutral. What makes them good or bad is a very simple question. What did you learn from this? If you got hurt and learned nothing, then that's a bad experience. If you learned something and you can go forward as a wiser person, then it was a good experience, even if it hurt. Mark Twain put it this way, there is nothing to be learned from the second kick of a mule. Everybody gets kicked sometimes. Not everyone learns from the experience. So looking back, let's pause to ask the question, what have we learned this past year? Let's start with this. First of all, we are all connected. And that means all of us, the whole world. A year ago, somebody whose name we'll never know in a part of China we'd never heard of started running a fever. Next thing you know, over 1/3 of 1 million American people have lost their lives to a disease we've never seen before. All the borders in the world could not stop that virus. Our no-fly zones and stay-at-home orders could not contain it. That's because the world is connected as never before. Yet, I'm afraid our ministries have often acted as if we're required to stay in one spot. We know the church is worldwide, but have we been too content to stay put in our own little corner? Can we imagine sharing the gospel in ways that touch people beyond our walls, throughout the Commonwealth, all over the nation, and all around the globe? Could the gospel become as contagious as any virus ever can be? Oh yes, but Pastor, how can our little church do that? I'm glad you asked. Because I'm convinced we have something the world needs, and I think 2020 showed everyone. People are angry. They're angry about racial injustice, angry about the election, angry about government restrictions, angry about everybody around them being angry. But psychologists tell us that anger is a secondary emotion. If you want to understand all that anger, you have to realize anger comes from fear. And fear is lack of trust set on fire. The Bible has the solution. 1 John 4:18 says, "There is no fear in love, for perfect love drives out all fear." Which fears are we talking about? Let's say it again. All fear, all distrust. That's what the world is seeking in 2021, and Grace Church has it in overflowing buckets. Every day, hundreds of people drive past our building, and they don't even know the treasure we have inside. In our church, race and ethnicity don't keep us apart. Political differences don't divide us. In our church, immigrant families are welcomed with open arms by folks who have "Make America Great Again" bumper stickers. In our church, there's no fear, no anger, no dividing lines. The perfect love of Jesus has cast out all of that stuff. So maybe it's time to realize we've got a message our world needs to hear. Maybe it's time to advertise it so the world can see it. Maybe it's time to make a little noise of our own. You know, hometown news media loves to cover human interest stories. And that's what perfect love does. It takes nameless people in the crowd and lifts them up and makes them human. We could do it with a massive yard sale. Invite your friends and neighbors to set up a table, and the price of everything there is $0.00. What? That's right, free, like the love of Jesus. If you see something you need, take it. If you have something of equal value, donate it. Let the news media know we're doing this to give back to the community. We're doing it to spread the love of God. Or have a picnic to honor our hometown heroes. Get them to bring police cars and fire engines and let them know we just want to say thanks for helping us through 2020. Let the neighborhood kids come and get a fire hat and a hot dog. Let the news outlets know it's not because it's 9/11. It's not to argue about police reform. It's just to say, thanks, y'all. God loves you, we love you, and there's nothing you can do about it. Maybe you've got an even better idea to connect to the community in 2021. Maybe you can think of other ways to let the whole world know. If that sounds like a good idea, then we all have to agree that we've learned something else. The church is not the building. Oh, sure, we've always known that. We teach our children to sing it. The church is not a building. The church is not a steeple. The church is not a resting place. The church is a people. I am the church. You are the church. We are the church together. All who follow Jesus all around the world. Yes, we're the church together. But if somebody back in 2019 had suggested, hey, y'all, for safety's sake, let's just close the church building for about a year and see what happens, we would all have thought they were crazy. Well, it has been crazy. We've had to figure this whole thing out on the fly, and I'll be the first to say we don't have all the answers yet. We still need to find better ways to care for those who aren't plugged in. We need to find new ways to disciple our children. And this physical isolation is getting to all of us mentally, emotionally, and spiritually. But we are reaching more people than ever with our worship. Our devotional lives are stronger and our unity has never been better. Our finances are in better shape than ever, and we've done it all without going into the building. The church is always strongest when we carry our faith outside the building. So where is God calling us to go next? Where will we carry our faith in 2021? Thinking of church as something you do inside a building has another consequence. It can create the unspoken attitude that we should just sit there and wait for people to come to us. Oh, sure, we invite them to come occasionally, but 2020 forced us to go outside of our walls to reach people where they live. And through this pandemic, a lot of us are living online, and we've done our best to reach out through virtual venues. We're reaching out with mailings to those members who aren't wired. And I don't think those forms of electronic fellowship will suddenly go away for us in 2021. I think we're going to be a wired church from now on. But when the lockdown starts to ease and the infection rate goes down, people aren't going to be tied to a screen anymore. Are we going to go back inside the building and wait for them to come? Or are we going to find new ways to get out amongst them that don't involve the internet? It's pretty clear that folks are going to be going outdoors to more events. We can reach them by tailgating at a ball game, cooking out at a local park, taking a prayer walk through a subdivision, having outdoor children's events without waiting for Halloween or Easter eggs, inviting the community to come join us in a workday, visiting firehouses or police stations. There are lots of ways to make grace visible outside the building and make our community better in the process. So let's go back to 2020 and back to our friend Wile E. Coyote. And let's ask again, what have we learned here? I confess, this is a different kind of message for me. I usually like to tell Bible stories and let the answers speak for themselves. But today, the answer is in these questions. What have we learned? How will that change the way we do church? How can our experience of 2020 make us a wiser, stronger church than ever? Before you answer, let's take a moment to pray. Lord, 2020 was like a big old anvil dropped on our heads. It sure did hurt, and it left quite a mark. Lord, let us learn from that experience. Make us wiser and stronger than ever before, so that your perfect love can cast out all fear. Lord, the world needs that love more today than ever, and you've blessed us with abundant buckets overflowing. Lord, let this be the year that grace abounds. In Jesus' name, amen. Now, about those questions, what have we learned about doing church? And how do you see God leading us in 2021?
Just